Hello friends, welcome to podcast Shakespeare. This is episode 9, a podcast bonus, Shakespeare's Sonnet number 1. This is a sample of the content that will be going up each week on my Patreon page, which is a chance for dedicated listeners to contribute a few dollars to the running of the podcast and to receive some exclusive content from me as a thank you. I will record each sonnet by Shakespeare, along with analysis, context, and any other gems we find along the way. You can find a link to the Patreon campaign in the show notes. My regular episodes about the plays and life of Shakespeare will continue to be released for free via your favourite podcast app. Thanks for listening. Hello friends, this is the first in my series of episodes exclusive to Patreon, focusing on Shakespeare's sonnets. Each episode I'll recite one of the sonnets, and then discuss some history and analysis. From fairest creatures we desire increase, that thereby beauty's rose might never die, but as the riper should by time decease, his tender heir might bear his memory. But thou, contracted to thine own bright eyes, feed'st thy light's flame with self-substantial fuel, making a famine where abundance lies, thyself thy foe, to thy sweet self too cruel. Thou that art now the world's fresh ornament, and only herald to the gaudy spring, within thine own bud buriest thy content, and tender churl makes waste in niggarding. Pity the world, or else this glutton be, to eat the world's dew, by the grave and thee. This first episode will be a little longer than usual, as I need to sketch some of the groundwork. Suffice it to say, a sonnet is a poem form which emerged in medieval Italy, and was in vogue around the year 1300, during the era of Dante and Petrarch, one of the most famous sonnet composers. The form was amplified and travelled throughout Europe, and by the 1580s and 90s had its heyday in English. Although the sonnet form is not set in stone, we know it best as a poem of 16 lines, three quatrains, that is, four lines with an A-B-A-B rhyme scheme, and then a final couplet of two rhyming lines. Shakespeare writes his in iambic pentameter, his metre of choice. There are arguments made that this metre, 10 syllables in total in patterns of 2, appeals especially to the English language. 8 syllables, a tetrameter, is too short, often comes out like a chant. 12 syllables, hexameter and beyond, work better in flowing languages such as Italian. They constrain the mental memory of a reader. But that's all theory for a later date. The sonnet typically contained a run of 8 lines on a single subject, followed by the so-called turn, in which the final 6 lines argue against or put a new spin on that subject. Sometimes the last 2 lines, the couplet, may have a kind of twist ending, or otherwise they might provide a moral to the tale. The sonnet has a storied history. One could say that it's an artist's art form. Young poets wrote and write sonnets to improve upon, respond to, or emulate older sonnets. And certainly Shakespeare's relationship with the form is complex. He was quite a latecomer to the scene. There was a vast, dazzling array of sonnets behind him in both English and other languages, and he is both bothered by and excited by the form. I say bothered because there are other Shakespearean sonnets. In his comedy Love's Labour's Lost, his male characters secretly compose sonnets, with a sense from the playwright that they are a little less than worthwhile. On the other hand, one doesn't write 154 sonnets if one isn't determined to add a little something to the genre. Sonnet sequences very often ran to or around 100. Some of the most famous of the day, 108 sonnets being a particularly popular number, were required reading for intellectuals. They're like a little series of linguistic experiments. In 14 lines, pick a theme or a startling romantic analogy, cram it full of wordplay and rhetorical allusions, make the syntax as complicated as you can without becoming tangled, and hopefully surprise us at the end. Of course, not every experiment works. Not every Shakespeare sonnet works. In any series, there will be strengths and weaknesses. and this is a writer from an average background using his own mind and wit to get by, not a pampered lord. The analogy I think of is the golden age of detective fiction, when authors like Agatha Christie and Dorothy L. Sayers churned out 1, 2, sometimes 3 books a year as well as short stories. This small but prolific group of writers were constantly trying to one-up each other, with an outrageous alibi or an incredible twist, an unforgettable detective, or simply a locked-room conceit that even their fellow authors couldn't crack. The pace at which those books were written, and the need for novelty given how many other books were coming out each year, mean that sometimes they read, to us, as cheap or improbable at best. Not that I would call Shakespeare's sonnets cheap or improbable, and some of his contemporaries are pretty remarkable as well, but we can read some of those in time. What I'm trying to say is, for the sake of this project, let's eliminate the idea of the Shakespearean sonnet as the be-all and end-all, the nonpareil of poetry. They're not. Structure, historical context, rhetorical analysis, they're all very important, and they'll make up the bulk of what I do with these episodes. But we should never lose sight of two things. First, that we should enjoy reading the sonnets. And second, that we should remember that a fallible human poet wrote them. If we can't explain a word or a sentence without resorting to 25 pages of textual discussion, we might have to question if maybe there's an alternate meaning, or even, as my favourite interpreter of the sonnets, poet Don Patterson, thinks, sometimes just a poet who didn't quite hit his mark with that line, whether from laziness, self-deception, or a rushed deadline. And one last thing before we pick apart this poem. I described how a sonnet works, the number of lines, the structure, the tone. But bear in mind that's a bit like following a creative writing textbook to the letter, or taking one screenwriting class and then creating the perfect film. The structure is the basis. It's the skill and knowledge any artist needs to have at their fingertips. A screenwriting class will teach you that every scene should move the plot forward. But the best filmmakers will quickly discover this isn't always true. A scene solely about character or atmosphere can be what makes a film memorable long after you're dead in the ground. And Shakespeare will be bound by convention much of the time, but quite often it's when he goes his own way that he makes magic. So what is sonnet number one about? It's not the easiest place to start, to be honest. From fairest creatures we desire increase, that thereby beauty's rose might never die. In other words, we hope that the most beautiful people will have babies, so that their beauty can live on in their children. Well, already this is not the subject matter of the typical sonnet. From Petrarch to Spenser, sonnets are seen as a romantic form, at least up until Shakespeare's time. And instead, the bard is using it to urge someone beautiful to have children. It's generally agreed that these early sonnets were not intended for publication. Many years later, they were published, and the jury is out on whether Shakespeare licensed to that. But most agree that the sonnets were written during the 1590s, that is, his first full decade in London, and the era when sonnets were especially in vogue. So why did he write them if not for publication? We don't know, but the first 17 sonnets in the sequence are variations on this theme of urging someone young to procreate. Procreate with whom, we don't know. Plausible suggestions range. There may have been something that spurred him on to try this subject matter, perhaps an entreaty to a friend, or perhaps they were charming pieces to woo someone into sleeping with him. Maybe it was a writing competition on this theme with a fellow poet. Or maybe there was no motive. Maybe these were just practice sonnets on a theme the author chose for no particular reason. But humans are narrative animals, and if we really want to seek a context for the poems, and like most people I do, then the most compelling theory is that the original 17 were a commission. A young man, possibly aged 17, is refusing to marry, refusing to settle down. His parent or guardian commissions a talented young poet to write a series of pieces. Now remember, by the mid-90s, Shakespeare had published two highly regarded epic poems, Venus and Adonis and The Rape of Lucrece. Both had been written for the favour of nobility, had presumably gained him some payment, and would have introduced his name into some of the finer homes of England. So it's not unreasonable to think that someone may commission work from him, perhaps especially if their young son had a love of those poems himself. And while I doubt the commission was specifically for sonnets, it makes some sense for 17 poems to match your young son's age, and that Shakespeare himself chose a form known for romantic connotations. The identity of the young man is best left for another time. Should we be suspicious? Should we ask why this young man did not want to marry a woman and settle down? There's no suggestion that the poet had met the young man, or that the kid was anything other than an average 17-year-old who wasn't ready for commitment. But we will feel the poems become more tender as the sequence goes on. At the same time, some would say that all of this is stuff and nonsense. Stephen Booth, whose commentary on the sonnets is perhaps the single text on the subject, has no time for any of this, or really for suggestions that Shakespeare had any homosexual leanings at all. To Booth, we don't need a context to read the poems, any more than we need to believe that Shakespeare was taming a shrewish wife to have written Taming of the Shrew. Advice to young people was a common trope from medieval times, as we saw in some of the sources for Two Gentlemen of Verona. This is an era in which Shakespeare writes many of his young person poems, such as Two Gentlemen, A Midsummer Night's Dream, Romeo and Juliet. It's not unreasonable that this is the origin of Shakespeare's motivation for these poems. So, deeply personal story, or completely impersonal linguistic exercise? Those options are the Scylla and Charybdis I'll be sailing through as we navigate this collection of poetry. So the poet is telling the young man, the speaker of the poem is telling the subject of the poem, that procreation is the way to further one's beauty. The language is not personal. We desire increase, that beauty's rose might never die. It's not about me wanting to see your beauty, it's about a global responsibility. Beauty is important. Beauty elevates us from this messy, warmongering, disease-laden 16th century existence we inhabit. And if you have beauty, you owe it to that beauty to perpetuate it. But as the riper should by time decrease, that is, as you age, his tender heir might bear his memory. That "but the riper" line isn't all that clear until we finish the next line. And even then, it's a little bit obscure. It's not quite the heights of some of the sonnets you may know better. And "bear his memory" has a couple of meanings, right? Your children will indeed bear your memory if they look like you. And even they will be the ones who remember you the longest after you're gone. But having children, the act of childbirth, is also bearing someone who will be a memory of you. And here in line 5, the poem takes its turn. Not after the second quatrain, but after the first. We've just been praising beauty, but now we're going to castigate the subject for not doing his duty to beauty. "But thou, contracted to thine own bright eyes, feed'st thy light's flame with self-substantial fuel, making famine where abundance lies, thyself thy foe, to thy sweet self too cruel." Yes, the subject is too self-absorbed. And now we're getting senses of how Shakespeare's mind works. He loves an opposite, the idea of making famine where abundance lies. He has beauty in abundance, but unless he perpetuates that, he will create a famine of beauty. Shakespeare adores these kind of riddles in his sonnets. And contracted can mean legally bound, especially in a marriage sense, which is relevant here, implying that the man loves himself so much more than others. But it also has a sense of being shrunk, of being reduced, as if he's shrinking his very beauty by letting it decay and not passing it on. There's a very early modern Christian sensibility here. Sure, there is a fearfulness to the acceptance that death will destroy even the most beautiful, but there are the implications of rebirth, of how the prime motivation of sex is to bring forth children, who will themselves be our ambassadors into the future. "Thou, that art the world's fresh ornament, and only herald to the gaudy spring." Well, now he's laying it on thick. This is the height of praise. Gaudy did not quite have the tone of excessiveness that we think of now. It means luxuriant and showy, but more appropriate. Spring's full beauty. And again, there's a sense that the subject is owned by the world, and that his life connects intimately to something as foundational as the very seasons. "Gaudy spring" takes us back to beauty's rose in the second line. Roses were typically a feminine symbol, but here Shakespeare connects the renewal of nature to the renewal of life through procreation and childbirth. Shakespeare's plays and poems have an astonishing amount of references to flowers and nature and animals, more than in most playwrights and poets of the day. It's one way that we can connect his heritage in rural Warwickshire to his work. And perhaps the use of the rose is also an unconscious linking of this beautiful young man to a feminine aesthetic. But we'll pick that up in future episodes. So you're amazing, the poet says. You're one of a kind. But within thine own bud buriest thy content, and tender churl makest waste in niggarding. The word tender appears again, and its primary reference, I think, is to nature. We think of young buds as tender. But it also operates as something of an oxymoron with the dismissive word churl, a word that means a miser, a hoarder. It's disrespecting the young man's choices, as he's hoarding his beauty. But it's an aside, oh tender churl. It's somewhat playful. It's part of a conversational element that Shakespeare creates that will run throughout many of these poems. One other thing that differentiates Shakespeare from several of his sonneteering contemporaries is that while he can be high-minded, his style usually reads something more akin to dialogue, and less like preaching. There are fewer mythological references and poetic apostrophes, that is, the O with an exclamation point after it. I choose to pronounce the word buriest as two syllables rather than buriest to fit the meter, and in future episodes we'll have to discuss more about the joys of making every vowel and every syllable sing to get the most out of this very, very beautiful poetry. But the line, within thine own bud buriest thy content, well, the idea of finding one's content within one's own bud, I don't think you need to have a dirty mind to suggest this is a reference to self-gratification. I have to say, if I were a 17-year-old going through puberty, and my parents commissioned this poem for me from some local poet, I would be mortified. And incidentally, you may know this, but the word at the end of that sentence, niggarding, means the act of being miserly. It's a word that has an entire Wikipedia page devoted to it, because unfortunately, its similarity to the famous racial slur means that a bunch of people take unreasonable offence to it, while another bunch of people apparently delight in using it in sensitive situations, despite hordes of synonyms they could choose, just to get a rise out of the first bunch of people. So that's a really pleasant example of rational human behaviour. It's not probably a word I'd trot out often, but in this case we do have to use niggarding, and we have to know it's etymologically innocent. The final lines of the poem put the onus back on the subject. Pity the world, or else this glutton be, to eat the world's dew by the grave and thee. This is again not the clearest of phrases. Essentially he's saying, do not be greedy. If you die childless, you are causing a loss to both yourself and the world. Think of the world, man! My preference would be to transcribe it with a colon after line 13 to make it clearer. In other words, pity the world. You want to know what kind of glutton you'll be? I'll tell you. You will be eating, that is, consuming, that is, destroying, the beauty you owe to the world. And then the grave will eat you too. This links back to the idea of feeding your flame with self-substantial fuel. The idea of a candle, which burns itself out, rather than a lantern which can be refueled to keep on going. And there's a cleverness in the use of the word glutton. The speaker has just been saying that the young man is a hoarder, a miser for keeping his beauty to himself. But paradoxically, he's also a glutton, the opposite of a miser, as he's selfishly keeping his beauty. And the last line is all one-syllable words. Typically, the longest words in English had come from French, and the shorter ones were likely to be Latin, German, or indeed, at one syllable, Anglo-Saxon. And there's a rhetorical power in one-syllable words, a confidence, a determination, ending the poem with that flat statement of 10 single words has a certain didactic power. It's not just a request to procreate. It's an exhortation. So there we have it. Sonnet number 1. We don't actually know if it was written to be the first in a sequence, or indeed if it was written after some of the others. But either way, we already have here a number of words that will appear over and over again as core themes in the sequence. Beauty, roses, spring, heir, as in one who inherits, memory, eyes, light, world, waste, and grave. And let us not forget that duty that the young man owes to the world. That poetic strand will only appear on occasion, but when we reach the last sonnet dedicated to this young man, number 126, that payment will have come due. Thank you for listening. I hope you've enjoyed this sonnet, and I'll see you next time for number two. From fairest creatures we desire increase, that thereby beauty's rose might never die, but as the riper should by time decease, his tender heir might bear his memory. But thou, contracted to thine own bright eyes, feeds thy light's flame with self-substantial fuel, making a famine where abundance lies. Thyself thy foe, to thy sweet self too cruel. Thou that art now the world's fresh ornament, and only herald to the gaudy spring, within thine own bud buriest thy content, and tender churl makes waste in niggarding. Pity the world, or else this glutton be, to eat the world's dew by the grave and thee.